That little drum intro was a shout out to Neil Peart.
May
he rest in peace. The morning coffee mug Zoom here. It's coming at you, people.
Yeah, morning. I got my dog.
It's the wiener dog mug.
It's the wiener dog.
Good morning, everybody.
Hello, gang.
Thanks, Joe. You like my hair? Thank you.
Good times.
I figure I don't work in an office anymore. I can do whatever I want with my hair.
It's perfect.
Brent and I say the exact same thing all the time. I can do whatever I want with my hair.
That's right. You know,
you totally know that Brent used to do that move.
Yeah, he does kind of have the hair flip down, doesn't he?
Yeah, he
had some rock and roll.
Sad but true.
Yeah, me too. Anyway, all right. Oh, Shannon, thanks for joining us here today. And welcome to everybody. Some chat going on already. Some good stuff happening in the conversational portion of our program here today. Let's jump in. Shannon, give us the quick bio of yourself. I know you've been with us a few times, but we always have new folks. So always good to give everybody a little bit of background on who you are, what you do, and those kinds of things before we jump into the real conversation.
The real conversation. All righty. So for those of you not in the know, my name is Shannon Tipton. I own a company called Learning Rebels, and Learning Rebels works with organizations to primarily with their micro-learning strategies, deconstruction of content, reconfiguring their learning technologies so that we can get people to be better, smarter, faster, like their businesses need them to be. So this is where I like to spend my time.
Very cool. Very cool.
Yeah.
And we have our topic today is using communities and various, you know, community tools and strategies, et cetera, to help make the standard e-learning become the exceptional. I'm fascinated by this because, of course, we have a tool that helps people make e-learning things.
Right.
But how do we help people go beyond simply what can often end up being just, you know, information presentation, and maybe a 10 question quiz that gets stored as data in the LMS, and
right.
And then what happens then? So, you know, nothing. Strategies to help people get out of that mode and beyond. Yeah. Nothing. Yeah. Nothing. Anyway.
Excuse me.
So I'm really looking forward to this conversation because I actually never thought of, you know, turning to some of the other tools where we do communicate as a way of sort of extending learning and right. taking things further, et cetera. So, I mean, give us maybe a bit of a background on when you started doing this and how you started, you know, moving in this direction with some of the projects that you do.
Sure. I started thinking about communities when I started doing my own workshops, you know, so I didn't have access to an enterprise social network, right? So how can I work around this? What can I do? And a few options, you know, came through my mind. I thought, you know, you can always do a private Facebook group. So that's one. And you could do a LinkedIn group. You could do that. You could just do something informally through emails or set something up on WordPress, but that just seemed too hard, you know, and I'm all about the easy, just not only for my people, but for me, you know, because I am a one woman shop. So how much really can one person do, right? Mm-hmm. And so I thought, well, you know, Brent and I have been part of a Slack group for what feels like a forever. And I thought, you know what? I wonder if I could utilize that. And so I piloted it in one workshop that I had. And what I did, rather than doing it as a community before the workshop occurred, it was let's try to create a community during the workshop. So sort of wiki-esque, if you will. Mm-hmm. So I set up a few different channels you know, it was a Ask Me Anything, which is still always part of my channels. It's a Ask Me Anything, resources. And then the workshop was broken into groups. So you had group one, group two, group three, group four. And then you had what I refer to as wow notes. Okay, so those light bulb moments. And I thought, okay, here we go. Here's what we're going to do. And I introduced it to the group. It took a few minutes because this was a few years ago when Slack wasn't quite as integrated as it is now. So it took them a little bit to get logged in and everybody so that they could view all the channels. And but once it started going, it really started going, especially being that I didn't put any parameters around it. I didn't tell them what they had to write down, when they had to write down. All I did was provide them with nudges that said, hey, you know, what was your takeaway from that? Put that in the wow notes. And then for the groups, each group had a project that they were working on. So their project notes would go within their groups. And so and that's how it started. And I thought, oh, you know what? I think this has legs. And then and what I really saw was that they continued to communicate after the class. And that's when the Ask Me Anything channel became alive. Because that really was a, hey, you can ask the facilitator, the subject matter expert, as it were, in this case, you could ask me anything that you want, you know, and for 6 weeks afterwards, I kept it alive. So that way I got the notifications, I could go in and answer them, and then they can do what they want. And every once in a while now, I had a group set up for a client of mine, oh, probably a couple of years ago, and still every once in a while I get pinged through that. So it's like, oh, that's interesting. They're clearly still on it, even though I've archived it, you know? So it's, so through that, it just started building. And now I start using it as a pre-community builder, during workshop builder, and afterwards. So that's how it started.
Cool. And those workshops were, where you were starting, were those like online webinars or were those in-person workshops? They were live, but internet-based.
Correct. They were live in the classroom.
Okay. So you were actually using this as part of classroom training.
Right.
Cool.
And then that's when I took it offline. So it's like, okay, now I can I make this work with clients that I'm working with that are online versus face-to-face? And so then I started playing with different formats, but I wanted to pilot when I could see the eyeballs of the people, you know, read their body language, answer their questions, see what struggles that they were having, you know, because one of the earlier challenges is that when people would log into Slack, you didn't see the channels. You had to add the channels.
That's right.
They had to add the channels, you know, so that was a stumbling block. So it's like, okay, how do I get around that? You know, so it was good to be able to do it live so I could see it.
Yeah. Have you seen that's always the hardest part about introducing something new in a situation like that, because you do now have to build in time into your workshop to be like, okay, well, I'm going to have to teach these people how this new tool and how this structure works. But like you said, it's gotten easier. People, you don't have to spend so much time teaching people anymore. The ins and outs. It's just like, they're like, oh yeah, I'm in Slack. It's all good.
Yeah. Two things. One, either their companies are using Slack or they're using Slack. So Slack is becoming more commonplace than it used to be. And secondly, is that Slack itself has evolved as a tool. Mm-hmm. You know, so, you know, as it evolves, I can continue to evolve my approach, you know? So now what I do is there's a little, you know, micro video that I send out to people before they come. And it explains to them, if you've never used Slack before, boom, 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 this will get you in. If you want to learn more, here's a link, you know, where you can take a deeper dive if you want to, but just start with, this is all you need to know. And that is just like, people are like, oh, okay, that's all I need to know. Then that's all I need to know.
Yeah. There are so many pieces of this that I find really, really cool. Brian has asked a question, but it's a question about tools, but I'm thinking let's stick around methodology for a little bit and then circle back to specific tools. Cause I'm think that's kind of going to be a kind of a common question too. I was thinking ahead of our conversation of a whole bunch of different aspects of it. I mean, first of all, like if you were using this with asynchronous, like e-learning, versus you've got everybody sort of in a group and at a time, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Have you gone that route with any of with this, and how, what kind of differences have you had to contribute to that or figure out for that?
Yes. So yes, I do it now asynchronous.
Okay.
And the difference here is that you have to seed the conversation, you know, so you have to, you just, you know, it's not Field of Dreams here. If you build it, they will come, you know, that's nice to think, but that's not actually the case. And I think we all kind of know that. So setting it up, and one of the techniques that I like to use that I feel does work for me in an asynchronous environment is making sure that I don't sound like the teacher. You know, I sound like just a regular person, you know. So first, it's making that learning environment very friendly for them, very safe for them. So they feel like they're just having this conversation. And the other part of this is making sure that I'm actually responding. So I get a lot of people who are in my asynchronous workshops, either be client-based or what have you, that send me comments that say, I can't believe you're answering my question. Well, yeah. You know, so because a lot of them have been, you know, a part of an asynchronous online environment, either be it their workplace or online, and they ask questions and they never get responses because it gets buried in all of the others.
Bot, right? I mean, chatbots are really popular. And so maybe something like this gets set up, but they can tell it's just automated. It's just, there's this system in the background kind of putting in these fake answers into my system for me instead of having you right there live, which I do think is fantastic.
Yeah. So as a facilitator, you have to plan that. And that's what I tell people when I'm teaching this sort of technique when it comes to my blended learning programs, is that if you are going to carry through an asynchronous environment, you have to be prepared to spend that extra time. You know, so I had an asynchronous class just recently with a client, and there were 22 people in the class, and they were all very active, you know? So it's like, holy, okay. So one day I would log off and the next day I would log in and I'd have 30 comments. And it's like, oh, okay, better get like the big cup of coffee. But, you know, I went in and I responded to each and every person. So what happens is it encourages them to now respond to each other. They see me do it. It's behavior modeling. So they see me do it. They start to do it. Then the next thing you know, I don't have to do it as often.
Mm. Yeah. So some really cool things popping up in the chat already. Taruna was noting that you being responsive, and you just sort of summarized that as well, that it offers indirect nudges to others to add their own contributions to the discussion. They see mm-hmm. something going on, breaks down barriers, ice-breaking mm-hmm. kind of a feature. Gail's asking, Shannon, how do you manage your time? How do you set expectations from the attendees to not respond, you know immediately in the hour and et cetera? Yeah.
Well, I tell them that, first off, I'm not 24/7. So I said, remember back in university, you had office hours for your professors, right? So it's the same thing. There are office hours for me, and these are my office hours. And this is when you can expect me to be live and responding to your questions. So if you happen to pop in and ask me a question, I'll be there. You know, so it creates more of a one-on-one. But I'm really upfront, and this is where I put together at the very beginning, for a lack of better terms for my audience, because I know my audience understands what I'm talking about, is I'm putting a learning contract together. And that learning contract is between them and me. And here's what I expect out of you, and here's what you can expect out of me. So you can expect me to answer your questions, you know, within 24 hours, unless you're asking it on a Friday, then I'll get back to you in 48 hours, because I try not to do this sort of thing on the weekends. So that's how that's going to be set up. You can, these are the sorts of questions you can ask me. When the ask me anything category is all about this, or this channel is about that. So I set up the expectations for them, but I also tell them that the expectation is for you to participate. And part of the feedback that you're going to get from me for your employer or whomever it is that they're doing this class with is me to tell them how responsive you've been, because that's part of the whole, that's part of the whole setup. Now, for people who are with me, so my people, I tell them, it's again, your responsiveness is just all what you are going to get out of this class. You know, you get what you put into it, garbage in, garbage out. And I tell them that. And a lot of times we don't tell them that, you know, because we don't set the expectation. And also we don't behavior model that expectation. So we tell them they've got to be in all the time, but then we're not ever there, you know? So I think there's fingers that point back and forth. You know,
I'm curious to know if anybody in the chat has implemented something like this internally within their, within their enterprise. If they're doing training and training management in an enterprise setting, have you done this, or added this element to your training courses and your training design? Because it seems to me, I mean, you and I have been talking about this for a long time, that it should become sort of a new design model, really. And it could become more commonplace because, you know, the new tech kind of drives these new behaviors, which means it should drive new designs for us and new abilities to be able to offer this internally as a special, use case. But again, it's totally different. And so, yeah, I mean, there's issues we still kind of have to work through, the whole how much time do you spend on it and how much does that cost them? And, you know, whether you're internal or whether you're a consultant, you always have to price everything out and figure out what the resources are going to take and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, it being new, have you put together any sort of model yet at all? I mean, as to kind of what works or anything like that?
No, but I should probably. I haven't. That's a good idea. I do incorporate it into my instructional design workshops, my blended design workshops, you know, where we talk about this sort of thing and incorporating these different technology uses and some best practices for how to get engagement. Virtual training is the same sort of thing. I get these questions a lot, like in this sort of environment, we're in this virtual environment where facilitators, the number one question that facilitators always come to me with is that no one engages in the virtual classroom. And that is, and I hate to be so blunt, but it wouldn't be me, right? That's our fault. That's our fault, you know? Right. So that means we're not giving people enough time to answer questions and we're not giving them the appropriate amount of space and yada, yada, yada. So I certainly have these conversations when I'm with other facilitators or other L&D people, but I have not written it down yet. But that's a good idea, Brent.
So we have the chat is just going like.
Yeah, I'm trying to keep up.
I know. But I'm going to turn to some of the actual questions that have been posted. So Angela's asking, how do you keep the conversations focused in whatever tool? A lot of my learners hate having it on their phone when it goes off all the time and the quality conversation gets buried.
Sure. That's the other thing that people say, well, it pings me all the time. Well, you do have control of the notifications on your phone. Yeah. Turn the notifications off and make time for them to just do the same for them or advise them the same way you do yourself. Spend a half an hour during the day. And I thought I saw a question like this earlier. I'm sorry, I missed who asked it. So I set specific time periods. So when I'm in the middle of this sort of asynchronous classroom environment, it's the first half hour of my day. I'm going through, I'm online and I'm checking. Sometimes I need to spend the entire half hour answering questions. Sometimes there's no questions and I can seed a question and move on with my day. And so I instruct the participants to do the same thing. Find a period of time during the day to respond appropriately to whatever it is that they're working on. But tell them that again, you tell them that up front. So that way they have permission. They don't feel like they're neglecting the discussion. Say, no, this is, you know, this is what you're going to do. And actually, let's commit to that right now. Let's put that in your calendars right now. And you create that time like you would a meeting in your calendar. Mm-hmm. And that seems to work. That seems to work for most people, because then they feel like they don't have to listen for notifications all the time. So again, they've been given this permission to move on with their day.
Righto. Another question from Pamela is, once a new discussion topic is out, what strategies do you recommend to attract those users who haven't participated in that type of a discussion before?
Okay, so this works in conjunction with my email provider. So what happens is, if I'm starting a new discussion that people were not familiar with that they may miss, I hit it in a couple of places. I hit that directly in Slack, in the direct channel, so you at channel, so that alerts everyone that a message is coming through, and I announce it there. But also, all of my participants, Learning Rebels asynchronous people, are on my mailing list. So everybody's on a different mailing list. So I will physically send out a targeted email to those people to say, hey, you know, you all have been great. Love the conversation. Be aware that we've started a new conversation because that's what you have asked for, not because that was what it is, unless it's a new lesson. So if a new lesson has dropped, then I send that email out. Your new lesson has dropped. Here's a link to the Slack conversation. Let's go. Let's do it.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
There's a lot of angles to this too that I was thinking about. This starts bringing in as opposed to moving people from being something, you know, taking in something, sitting in your own, to moving it to a social realm. And I mean, that might be kind of an obvious statement, but it suddenly introduces you into being part of something. So there's all the benefits of that, of the slight angle of peer pressure, of, you know, public commitment to things, which often helps deliver, you know, follow through, et cetera. So that's a really nice, I think anyway, a really nice kind of leveraging aspect of all of this. I think it sounds like a really great opportunity as well to, like, use spaced repetition, right? To keep things,
oh, absolutely,
you know, the spaced repetition strategies, yep, fit very nicely with this too.
Yep.
So,
yep.
Have you done some things like that using spaced repetition specifically?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. So, I mean, my whole lessons are set up through learning reinforcement and spaced repetition.
Brilliant.
So, because it's important, and we mostly all know this, is that, you know, we want to bring that information that's been sitting in the back and growing dust, and we want to bring it up front. And that is through either asking questions in a slightly different way, mm-hmm, you know, making them think about it, or having them do something that's going to activate a different part of their brain. So sometimes with lessons, what I will do is, rather than say in the chat or in this channel, give me your five biggest takeaways, what I'll do is I'll say, draw me a picture of your five biggest takeaways, take a picture of it, upload it. Okay, so now what they're doing is like, oh man, she's having me draw something. Yes, I am. But I can't draw, and that's okay. Neither can I. And
no not drawing. They just have to watch last week's episode with Kevin Thorne.
See, there
and,
you go.
And we,
so
we've got the solution.
Talk about spaced repetition right there.
We just
brought back in Kevin. But it's, but yeah, I'll just, like, here's my little stick figure. So I don't expect you to do anything. I'll put up a few examples and show them what I mean. But throughout the time of the lessons, I'll do stuff like this. So that way it's spaced repetition without them being aware that it's spaced repetition.
Righto. Yep. And another piece of this is that's related to spaced repetition, but also a great opportunity to move people from, you know, from the lower level of info through to application. So you could start using this to extend it out to how have you used this, so that that people, mm-hmm, move into actually, you know, behavioral change as well.
Yep, exactly. So how have you used this week? What findings did you have? What changes did you experience based on your lessons, et cetera, which is all typical and, you know, slightly predicted. You know, so you want to try to bring in something that's a little surprising. And that's the whole bit. When you think about building a community is all about those surprising bits. You know, so if they can predict what you're going to do next, where's the fun in that? You know, where's the learning in that? You know, so if they know that you're going to ask that typical question of, so based on what you learned last week, how did that, you know, what are you going to do this week? And we all know that that question's coming. So how can we do something different? And most people have their answers, you know, planned for that. It's like, oh, I didn't know this. Yeah. So, you know, create those surprising moments.
Hmm. So how have you created those surprising moments?
Well, you know, like I said, the, you know, here, draw me a picture kind of thing. I like to use Coggle or MindMeister, you know, for mind mapping.
Righto.
So it's okay, groups, your group is going to create this mind map and you're going to send that back to me, where in the middle of that mind map is the lesson from this past week. You're going to mind map that lesson. What happened? And they're like, oh man, now I really have to think. So you really want to put them in positions where, or this is why I'm not a huge proponent of testing, is testing does not make people think. Stuff like this makes people think. And I want to see the proof of you thinking, you know, and I used to hate that back when I was in grade school, you know, when the math teacher said, show your work. And I'm like, ah, 2 + 2 = 4. Why do I have to show my work? You know, but this is why, you know, so, and, but again, it's fun for them. It's something different. It's that surprising moment.
Very cool. It also involves, you know, there's an angle of motivation in all of this as well. Yeah. You're using extrinsic motivation, because thou shalt join for this and do these sorts of things. But it's also, you know, sometimes we all need a good boot to the butt to get us actually moving in directions anyway. So
yes, yes. Big boots to my butts. That's for sure.
Have you ever, I'll dial up the conversation just one notch into sort of talking with management. Have you ever had a pushback or anything from a client or somebody that has said, I don't understand why you want to do this and make it part of it? It's, you know, have you had to do much convincing to, you know, to make it part of what they're getting or what you're selling or kind of thing?
Yes and no. Most managers understand that the community is important. What they don't understand is they say, well, I understand that's important, but they're not going to have time for that. Okay.
Right.
I understand that's important, but I don't want my people having rogue conversations about the company and things that we do. Okay. Or I understand that's important, but what happens if they say something incorrectly? You know, they give an incorrect response, or they're going to share misinformation because everybody's afraid that the misinformation fire, right, is going to grow. So those are the things that, big comment here. Okay, Thomas, I'll try to read that. So part of my conversations with management is addressing the time thing. So again, I go back to the office hours. And so I just had a client where I had this conversation with, and they said, well, you know, the holidays are coming up, so I don't want them to feel like they have to. And I'm like, I don't want them to feel like they have to either. And they were like, what? What? I was like, I get it. It's the holidays, and this is a retail organization. It's the holidays, and this is like truly your Christmas, you know? That's not saying that as an analogy. It's Christmas. I get it. So we can extend it. And they're like, oh, thank you for that. And I'm like, hey, I'm not the end all be all of timing here. You know, so once they're like, oh, okay, breathe. All right, so now what we can do is we can set these office hours and they can work in their groups. And I'm like, oh, that sounds easy enough to do. Absolutely. And I said, so now what are you going to do if they say something wrong? And I'm like, well, first off, when they say something wrong, I'm okay with that.
It's an opportunity.
That's right. It's an opportunity. I said, now, Joycelyn, wouldn't you rather see incorrect policies and procedures here? Because let's think of the process. I've asked a question. So they've got to think about that question. They've got to discuss that question with their group. They've got to come back to the Slack channel and type in that question. So that means that they feel so strongly about how they feel about that answer that they're probably not the only ones who think that. Wouldn't you rather catch it there and then have a conversation with people? And she's like, oh, I never thought about it that way. Okay. So I think that the other part of it is, well, you know, they don't have time, or, you know, I don't want people to go all rogue on the conversation, like I said, is the other one. And so my follow-up question to that is typically, help me understand what you're afraid of.
Yeah.
And that's a big question.
Yeah.
You know, help me understand what you're afraid of. And they say, well, I'm not really afraid. And I'm like, okay, so what's the barrier for you? Help me understand what that barrier is then. And so once you start to peel that onion back, then you can address whatever it is that's sitting in the middle.
I'm going to imagine a lot of times too that the fear is just a lack of understanding and a lack of clear picture of it. So right. It's a fear of the unknown,
right?
It's something, it's that newness. It's, you know, all of those sorts of things too, that probably underlies most of the things that, that people would raise as barriers.
Yeah. Paul Buffler. Hello, Paul, in the chat, mentions sort of the same thing, right? If you show it to them, it kind of helps them.
Right.
Start to get it a little
bit. They can visualize it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm reading through Thomas's, yeah. I'm reading through Thomas's comment, and thank you for all of that, Thomas.
Yeah.
Or Tom. I'm not sure which one you prefer to go by. I'll go Thomas, cause that's what it says. But yes, all of those things. So gift cards, I've done the gift card thing where, the first person to answer my question gets a $5 Amazon card. And they're like, well, damn, if I knew you were giving away shit. And I'm like, yeah. So surprise, you never know when that's going to come up. So I've used that technique, and I've kind of dropped that technique throughout, just in unexpected moments where people never know when I might drop in a prize. And so that also gets them used to coming in. And then you kind of back off the prizes little by little by little until they don't realize that you're not giving prizes anymore.
Mm.
Yeah, big shout out to Thomas Hurrell, by the way. A fantastic member of our industry and our community. We got to get him on the show sometime, Thomas. So I'm going to be pinging you after the show.
And thanks for adding all that detail in the chat.
Yeah, that was great. Thank you.
Yeah, it gives lots of folks joining us here another model to think about of mm-hmm. ways to do this. And also pointing out as part of that, because we've been mentioning tools, and there's been lots of chats about tools, but there are lots of different ways to go about this, and different tools will present different strengths and different advantages. A lot of Thomas's work seems to be done with email, so.
Yeah, it depends. As good instructional designers, right, we're analyzing the people, the content, the context, right? What is the work environment like? Maybe they're a Google shop, and you have to kind of do all of this inside of a Google chat or Google Hangouts. Or if they're a Microsoft shop, maybe you're doing it in Teams or in SharePoint or something like that. Or, you know, if they've got a custom-built thing, maybe you can whip something up there. Or maybe you set up your own. Maybe they've got nothing, and they're like, wow, we could really use some help here. So you're like, great, Slack will be perfect. Let's just set up a little Slack group, you know?
Right, and that's one of the other things that started me on Slack is that I didn't have a platform, and sometimes I couldn't get onto my client's platform, or they didn't have a platform. I saw, I'm sorry, I forgot, somebody else mentioned that they were using a discussion board and they discontinued it. And it's like, because discussion boards are crap.
Old,
you know, they don't, some of them don't thread, they don't ping you appropriately, you know, so some of them are really poorly set up because, you know, LMS companies have just said, oh, we need to have a discussion board, and they just throw one up there, you know, without putting a whole lot of thought into it. So that's why.
Yeah, and they are hard to monitor. You're right. And it's all about the notifications. It's all about the pings. It's all about giving the users the ability to manage that, giving you, the instructor, the ability to manage it, have a little bit of a plan, like what you do, you know, having the office hours. So this isn't sort of just turn it on and it's all of a sudden going to work, right? We've all made that mistake inside of big companies. And it's like, it has to be fostered. It's that whole garden analogy, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Jennifer, I'm sorry, and I see Jennifer's comment here that discussion boards are out of sight and out of mind. That's totally true. I mean, nobody, which one of us have woke up in the morning and say, oh, I can't wait to get into my LMS discussion board today? You know,
Slack is right there, and it's pinging you saying, hey, you know, some of your friends have been chatting you up. You know, you should jump in there, right?
And right. All that, yeah.
You know, or any other tool like that.
Yeah, and I saw somebody else had a question here about being, boy, this chat is just moving so fast. Let's see. Something about being the least creative person, and did I have any books to recommend? And yeah, actually, I have one right here on my desk, The Virtual Training Tools and Techniques from Cindy Huggett. So try that one. That's new off the shelves, actually, relatively new on the shelves. And that's a really great book about different techniques that you can use, you know, to get your creative mindset going.
And you know what, you can, I'll also give a quick shout out to Cassie Labori's book as well. She's got a fantastic book on 50 different creative ways to engage.
Yeah, I saw Cassie here. Hi, Cassie.
Yeah, so tons of options out there in different ways, and lots of folks out there with some great, great tips on how to utilize this tech to be more creative, to be surprising, to engage people.
That's it.
And in different, you know, informal ways, but formal ways also. You know, it all depends on your design and how you do it. But that was very brave of you, whoever said that about, I don't feel very creative, can you offer something out? That was brave of you to drop that into the chat. And I would like to commend you for saying so, because I think there's a lot of people probably thinking it, but nobody wanted to say it. So,
yeah. And let me tell you, some of these things were just, and I'm sure like Cassie could attest to, you know, you don't wake up just saying, oh, gee, great idea. You know, some of these things, and I was not always the most creative person, and I'm probably still not the most creative person, but I see things and I read books that make me go, how could we use this? And a lot of them are, you know, the like Elaine Beek's book, 101 Ways to Engage People Beyond the Classroom. So she's got that book. And so you think about, these are all these classroom type of engagements. Okay, so how can I take, you know, like the drawing one, draw me a picture. Okay, so that's typically a classroom thing. You give people a piece of flip chart, people, and they do it there. Okay, so now how can I make that work virtually? And that's not really being creative. That's me taking an idea that's already out there and going, how can I get people to do that in a virtual setting?
Or you could be in it, and that's how it sparks it, right?
Yeah,
like
right.
You said earlier, right? We're in this Slack group, and all of a sudden it's like, hey, kind of what we're doing here might work for this workshop.
Exactly, exactly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Good times. Boy, we're starting to get close to that time where we want to start wrapping things up, eh, Chris?
Yep. This has been one of the, I think, most active chats we've had in a while. And so that's been absolutely brilliant today, and so many things. I got to go back through so many notes to just even go back and archive, and we've had such a hard time keeping up with it. There's been so much activity going on.
Yeah, I was trying. Yeah, go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, all I was going to say was, you mentioned earlier, Shannon, like, oh my gosh, there's so much going by, just trying to keep up there. So, if there's any open questions, toss them either in the chat or in the questions quick here. We might be able to squeeze them in still.
Yeah. But I saw a question about Slack. You know, was Slack the tool of choice? It is for me, because I, you know, squirrel, you know, something shiny. And I'm playing with a couple of other new tools right now that I'm not going to put out into the open just yet, because I haven't worked it out yet. But those of you who are part of my newsletter, if you get my newsletter, if you signed up for a pilot group that I'm going to be working on here shortly, I'm going to send out another newsletter this week. So that'll give you an opportunity to sign up for the pilot for another new network. And I'm working through the bugs in that.
Yeah. It's learningrebels.com?
Yeah, learningrebels.com. Mm-hmm.
So one last question that we will slide in, because it's been asked a couple of times and then thrown in the question, is about, you know, measuring interaction within a tool like Slack. Is it something that you're trying to measure at all, or can you, or?
You can, but why? You know, so you could. Now, if you're thinking about quizzes and tests and that sort of thing, you know, you could link it to a tool like Kahoot, you know, where you could get, you know, some sort of measurable result from pop quizzes or quizzes or something along those lines. But I have seen other instructors and they've got a spreadsheet, you know, and they've got names of everybody who's in the class. And then they put a tick mark next to their name every time they've responded to something. And it's like, wow, no. What, I'm inherently lazy. So no, yeah, I'm not going to do that. But to me, it's about not how often you've commented, but the quality of conversations that you are a part of. And like a live setting, the virtual setting is the same. You've got thinkers in your class, yeah, you know, and they're not always going to be the ones to talk, you know, but when they do bring something up, they bring something up that has value. And so that's what you want to see, is who are the people who are contributing in a quality way. And then you can report that back, you know, to management, and you can say, you know, Bob, Sue, Joe, those are your thinkers in the group. And those are the ones who came up with the great, you know, ideas. And here are the ideas. Here's what's come out of the community. And that's what I like to present to my client, is these are all the different ideas. These are the best practices. These were the group's discussions that you can now take and run with. So it really doesn't matter who, it matters what.
Yeah. And the expectation of expecting people or telling people that they must participate by a certain amount, that just leads to superficial participation anyway. People just want to jump in, post something just to meet the check mark. And right. So there's no depth. There's no, or certainly not encouraging of depth or reflection. So
it's the 21st century version of butts in seats.
Yeah. Right? Yes, it is. And we don't need that. I love that. Laura, she said a network analysis. Wow. That's a great idea. I should write that down.
And you know, so tools will, they do give you analytics, right? You can like pull up a chart that says, here's the percent of people that have engaged. Here's the people, the
clicks
list that have engaged the most and blah, blah, blah. So you do get some data if a client or your internal manager needs to know that for whatever reason. It's not that hard to get.
No, because if you're running drop lessons through emails, which I do a lot of, that's the other thing that I do a lot of, which is a topic for a whole different day. But you could get Google Analytics through all of that, you know, if that's what you need to have. But I love the idea, Laura, of, you know, what, you know, when you analyze the quality, what are the matrix behind the quality? And now, now you got my brain spinning on something. You know, so much for my plans for what I was going to do after this.
Squirrel. That's probably a good place to run the music. Give us a chance to dance out of here, folks. This has been a great session today. As we've noted, lots of activity in the chat. So I think everybody's having a squirrel moment and going to go away with thinking thoughts and doing things. So, gang, thanks so much for joining us here today. Shannon, thanks so much for being our fabulous guest, as you always are when you join us.
Thank you.
And lots of stuff going on in all of our brains. So thanks, everybody.
Good times.
Thank you.
Drop the links in. Don't forget, Shannon. I did it once, but you can do it again.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. Yeah. LearningRebels.com. Sign up for the newsletter. Good stuff happening there with my pilot program.
Awesome. Let's dance out of here.
Yeah. Vogue.